We wish to thank the organizer for this opportunity, which is very nice. I will work on projective space, so I fix a vector space, complex vector space, which I call V, and the dimension is n plus 1, and PV is projective space of lines, projective, sorry, of lines in V. Okay, so the aim, the object of this lecture is study some coherent sheaf on projective space and try to understand the resolution of F information that we have there. And this is very important in algebraic geometry, but there is a particular example that when you have a projective sub-variety, then you have very important examples like the structure sheaf of the variety or the ideal. This is the ideal sheaf of the variety. And the resolution of these sheafs are called the resolution of the variety and give a lot of information on the variety itself. So basically, the idea is try to have first equation of x, then this equation can have some relation, then you find the relation of the relation, and so on. I will see. So first, I need one important background, which is the Kozul complex. And I start from here. So I pick, this is P alternating power. So sometimes it's called the wedge, P of V, and SQV is the Q symmetric power, okay? So these are tensor spaces, but the second one can be seen just as the space of homogeneous polynomial of degree Q over V. So this is quite important. Both have finite dimension. Then the all the second spaces come together if you take the direct sum. This is called S, and this is the degree Q part of S, and there is also, of course, nothing that else than the space of polynomial over V when this is a basis of V. Okay. So start from this is the determinant, the top wedge power, and you tensor by. Okay, this I don't define formally, but I think is well known. This is a graded ring, and this is just. The shift of the graduation of the graded ring. Then you go here, then again here, and you can continue until you arrive to this part and then S minus 1 then you have S itself, and then you conclude with the field. The field is the complex. So how they are defined? You pick a dual basis then you have this tensor so the dual basis of the dual here then this is nothing else than the identity and is independent. From the basis. So I think here I did the strategical mistakes because these are polynomials, so sorry. Of course it's just a convention, this is the same. And then at each step this is just the contraction by this element. One appear over the wedge and it's one, and the other one is the multiplication of the symmetric power. And in terms of representations, at degree p, you have, for example, wedge PV tensor SQV, and you go here, so this can be seen in the following way. These are SLV modules, so are representation of SLV, and they can be classified, and all of them are irreducible and depend by some Young diagrams. And these two, symmetric and alternating power, are just the two extreme cases. This correspond to just P boxes in one column, and this is Q boxes in one row. Okay? Then when you perform the tensor product of these two representations, it splits exactly in the following way. So first you have here P, and then you just add the row here, so you get Q plus 1. And then you have another possibility that one box here just go on the bottom and you get P plus 1 boxes. And here remain only Q. Okay? If you do the same here, you have first P minus 1 and then Q, and then again sorry, Q plus 1, because it is this one and I add 1, so Q plus 2. And then I add one box more, and then you get P and Q plus 1. And you see that just two of them are equal, and the other two are just different. So in this complex, at each step, this map, which is in SLV invariant, and is just the contraction, takes one of the two summand to itself as an isomorphism, and the other go to zero. So this is just the kernel which coincide with the image of the previous one. So this is exact, and it's called the Kozul complex of the vector space. And look, for example, at this piece. Here you have the following description. At each step, V is just n plus 1 copies of this, so a basis here is H0HN. And this gives locally in, well, not locally, this is global, in just the sum times XI. And what happens here you get the element are many copies parametrized by wedge 2, so you can just pick a basis given by two indices I and j different, which are a basis here, and this goes in the following. You get xj at place I and minus xi at place j. And you see, of course, that these are solution of this, so these are particular syzygies. And the exactness means that all the syzygies, so all the HI which make this vanish, are generated by these, which are so-called the Kozul syzygies, and are the first examples. So let's record this. All HI such that this is zero are generated by the special case when you have xj at place I and minus xi at place j. Okay. Now I want to sheafify all this. So Kozul complex for sheafs, and I call O the sheaf corresponding to S, and OM the sheaf corresponding to the twist. And it's also usual convention that any, if you have any coherent sheaf and you tensor by OM, this is denoted just FM. This is just a notation. Okay? Then if you 3 months exact, the only thing which disappears is the field, and because it's Artinian module, so it corresponds to the zero shift, and then you get O, then you have a V tensor O minus 1 wedged to V okay, and this is again exact. Okay, now what is important, we can understand the kernel here. So I claim that now the kernel of this map is just omega 1 of PV. So the bundle of one forms. Then this is a kernel here, and the second step here you have omega 2. And so on, all the kernel in the Kozul complex are just the bundle of p-forms. This is crucial for all the description I want to give in Beilinson theorem. So I want to sketch the argument, why. I will prove just for omega 1, but then the proof of omega 2, omega 3 is essentially the same. Sorry, it's a bit long as an introduction, but I think it's important to have a solid basis, a foundation. So I will introduce the following. Take UI just the point of projective space where the height coordinate is non-zero, so it is so-called standard affine covering of projective space. Then you have local coordinates, zeta j equal to xj times xi for all j, of course, different from I. So for example, on U0 you have zeta 1 up to zeta n, and now you have a formal computation which is the following, that d zeta I can be computed formally in the following way. This is d xi times x0 minus xi times dx0. So this is just the Leibniz rule to apply a differential. But now you see these are true local coordinates, so this is really a one form. And then these are just a symbol, but they are useful to change from one coordinate to another coordinate. And look what happens here. You have x0 at I and minus xi at zero. So it is exactly the same thing we found here. So they satisfy this equation. And then you get the following, that as a shift, U Pn is equal to PV open. Open affine omega 1 pn over u can be described by sum hi dxi, where hi is a rational homogeneous of degree minus one, regular over U. So this means it's a quotient of two homogeneous polynomials, but the degree of the denominator is one more than the degree of numerator, so the it comes minus one, but still I miss the basic thing, such that this is zero. Okay, I think now you understand that this is a meaningful construction, because the solution here are just given by this one, and this comes by true one forms. And for example, this is a quotient of homogeneous, and these are regular over U0. And here you ask that the denominator is never vanishing over U. And then from this description, it's clear that this is just the kernel of this map, because this is a multiplication by the basis, and this is the condition. Okay, and then you get omega 2, omega 3, omega 4. So what will be very important, not important as this information, but almost, that omega p, so this is bundle of p forms twisted by p, these are remarkable bundles on Pn. When I say bundle, I identify a vector bundle with a locally free sheaf, as usual. And these are called building blocks. I want to explain why. Because the philosophy of the Bailenson theorem that now I want to state is that any coherent sheaf on projective space can be constructed by building blocks, if you just put them together with carefully. I think the preliminary are finished, so I can give you the statement. So, the statement is the following. Let F be a coherent sheaf on Pn, the complex projective space. Then there is a complex started by minus n plus 1. At some point you arrive to L0, then you go on. And the basic thing is that these pieces are constructed just by the cohomology of F. So LK is the direct sum for all integer number j and I satisfying this equality of omega jj tensor hi I will explain now some example, but first you see this is just a vector space. So this LK means that you have many copies of omega j. The number of copies of omega j is given by the dimension of this cohomology group. And so these are the building blocks. I promised you that with the building blocks I have to recover F. And then I maintain this, let's call the map D. I hope that, no, I need a second blackboard. Sorry, I was too large, such that the kernel of the I quotient by the image of the I minus 1 is equal to F for I equals 0 and 0 for all other I.
Sorry, where is tab J? Is tab 0 or?
In principle, it can go an integer, but of course these are zero for j bigger than n and smaller than zero, so j, but it's not necessary to write because omega n plus 1 is zero, so it's just to be and you see that this is really a complex but is almost exact. So it is exact in all pieces unless the central part, the zero. The cohomology here is F. So this theorem is a big gun that is one of the fundamental results. It's quite interesting that was proved by Bailinson when he was 18 years old. So it's not a joke. But it's really important. He gave a proof of 2 pages, almost not readable by anybody else, but then it has been expanded and expanded and and I will tell you something more. The original proof of Bailinson used derived category, so use a big gun, but then it's not difficult in the sense that there is a big machinery and sometimes this is told in the following way, that the derived category of complex of coherent sheaves on projective space is as a triangulated category is freely generated by these pieces which are called the building blocks, but essentially this is equivalent to what I have just said. Then Eisenbud and Schreier gave several years later proof of Bailinson without using derived category, the so-called Tate resolution, and arrived to the same result. For example, back as a byproduct, you get a very powerful computational tool. If you use Macaulay 2 and you want to compute the cohomology of a coherent sheaf on projective space, Macaulay 2 uses this very powerful machinery. There is something which is still a black box, the maps, the I. I have not said anything. Well, they are not completely uniquely determined, but part of them is natural and other part is known only up to homotopy. But still, this is enough to use and apply this theorem. Now, my philosophy is that I don't pretend to give a proof. I start from this, I give for granted, but then I use this theorem to show as a consequence several results, okay? So first, try to unpack this theorem on P2, what happens. On P2, let me write the following table. You see, it's just a 3 times 3 square with some mistake that you have to find. And no, sorry, I am a bit tired, but no. So you see that here is h0, here is h1, here is h2, and f minus 1, f minus 2. Why I write this? Because now you understand that on this diagonal there is what is called L0. On this diagonal is L minus 1, and here is just L minus 2. So these are just the dimension which appear in the formula, and you see there very few of them appear. Here there are 3, but then 2 and 1. And to be precise, everything is multiplied by the following. Omega 2,2 is again a line bundle, and believe me, it is just O minus 1. So now the recipe is the following. Pick this square, keep and put here, and make the tensor product of this with this, of this with this, like here. And now you really get L0, L1, L2. So you see that very few terms remain. And now you understand also that you have some maps. For example, from L0 to L1 means from these 3 pieces you go to these 2 pieces, and for example this part can go here, here, and anything else. This is the part which is well understood because it comes just from the natural, like in the Kozul complex, there was a natural multiplication from minus 2 to minus 1 which behave well with this one. And this part is natural. This part is the one which is defined up to homotopy. Okay. Particular cases. If Li are 0 for I positive, this means that in the diagram you just have 0 here, and this is just ask some cohomology vanishing, okay? Then Beilinson gives a left resolution. And now this is exact, okay? And I don't write, but there is a dual statement that if the 0 are on the down, so if they are 0 for negative I, you get right resolution. And this is the important thing. Okay, first result. Su Horrocks criterion, I will prove the following form. Let F be a torsion free sheaf on PN, then F is the sum of some direct sum of some line bundle. This say that F splits the sum of line bundle. These are the simplest coherent sheaf if and only if the intermediate cohomology vanish for all I between 0 and n, and if I put a star means for every element, so the module is 0. So this is called the intermediate cohomology. This was proved by Horrocks with the assumption that this is locally free. And so this is a bit stronger than Horrocks' original criterion, and it comes immediately because
if you know the every
forward room
is density, then
the
shape is locally
torsion free or locally. So I write here a good question, because F on PV where torsion free is equivalent, so let try not to make mistakes, that HI FT is 0 for I smaller than n and T sufficiently negative. So if you go enough less, enough on the left, I think this should be correct. There is one basic example. Well, if you pick the structural sheaf of one point, then you can twist. This is, does not depend on the twist, so you can twist for anything you wish, and the cohomology remain non-zero. The H0 for any t, so, and this is not torsion free, and the same you can construct for a subvariety of dimension c, you arrive up to c. So okay, let's let's give the proof of Horrocks. So the part, so Horrocks is this one. There are two implications. The part implication on the right, of course, is well known. See, for example, Hartshorne's book. It's a basic computation, but the nice part is the other, because it gives a cohomological characterization that you have information on the bundle just by some cohomology vanishing. So pick M such that H0 F m minus 1 is 0, h 0 fm is different from 0. Okay? And such m exists by the assumption that it is torsion free. And then apply Baylinson to this bundle FM. So in the diagram you have H0 FM, and then the elements which the important thing is this is 0, and the elements of L minus 1 are all 0 because all are intermediate, because the only problem could be just in the top row, but in the top row you arrive here, and this is one less. So L minus 1 is just given by all 0. So in the complex, all the arrows which arrive to, you have O tensor H0 FM is summoned in L0. All arrows arriving adjust this one and start from zero elements, so are zero. But also the arrow which start are zero, because there is anything, because the Baylinson complex, all arrows starting are zero. And then if in a complex you have one element which everything which started zero, everything which arrived at zero, this is just a direct summon in the cohomology. Then Fm is just O tensor by this direct sum some other piece. And so you, this was non-zero. And then if you do induction on the rank, you arrive with a smaller rank bundle, which again has intermediate vanishing cohomology, and you can repeat the game here. And after finitely many steps, you close. So you see, it's really trivial. And okay, let's say, quote a corollary, just to quote some Italian guy that I call Segre Grothendieck, that all torsion-free, which means locally free sheaf on P1, split as direct sum of line bundles. Why this is a corollary? Because the assumption of Horrocks holds automatically, because there is no intermediate cohomology. And this was proved by Corrado Segre in 19th century, but is also equivalent to other statement Herbert Lange before make me remind about the book of O'Connick, Schneider, Spindler. There is a history about the theorem. To be fair, I have to quote also, I think, Dedekind, Weber, I mean, a lot of people proved. Anyway, Grothendieck was the last one to prove, and he proved Sue's wonderful theorem that I think for him is not so good to be known in this just for such a result, which is interesting. Of course, Corrado Segre did not prove in this language, and also Dedekind, they proved other things. Corrado Segre worked geometrically that for him a vector bundle on P1 was a so-called ruled variety, so a variety with many linear spaces parameterized by this curve. And split means that you can construct the sections, and then you can globalize the variety as a direct sum of smaller and simpler things, but essentially was equivalent. Okay, so I have to speed up, but no, I think I will do this other application, and probably my time for today is over. This is another Italian, but it's not my fault, that is Mumford himself that quote Castelnuovo. This in the there is a beautiful red book by Mumford of Princeton, not the red book of schemes, but it's called Algebraic Curves on Surfaces, and there is one chapter when there is this proof, and Mumford given 5-6 pages, but using Beilinson now you will see it's very simple. This is a criterion that a bundle be globally generated. Well, essentially say that if HIF M minus I is 0 for I positive and some M, fix M, and this is vanish for positive, and this is called that F is M regular, then FM is globally generated. Moreover, HI FM prime minus I is 0 for I positive and M prime bigger or equal than M. That means that the regularity extends for Eiger indices. And also, it's interesting, I think, this fact that you see, you have a natural map of tensor product of section from Fm of 1 in H0 Fm plus 1. And that this is the same M. And the statement say that this is surjective. Oh la la, oh, sorry. No, I need to. Okay. Before to prove this, let me quote maybe a curiosity, but not important remark before I give the proof. Let F different from zero, any coherent sheaf non-zero, then for every M exist I such that HIF Okay? This has to be true, because otherwise apply Beilinson to Fm, and these are just the summands which appear in L0, and if they are all zero, then L0 should be zero, and by Beilinson F should be zero, which is a contradiction. So this is important. You see that in this assumption I miss I equals zero, but it's important to have this feeling to go on. Okay, proof of Castelnuovo-Mumford criterion. Apply again Beilinson. So in L0, now you have O tensor H0. Sorry, I was not precise. Apply Beilinson, of course, to Fm. Then all the other summands in the diagonal are zero. And then what happens? Here you go to zero. Then pick, for example, this element. You see that all the arrows which arrive here are again zero, by the same argument as before, but also all arrows leaving from here, starting from here, are zero. And then this is a direct summand of L1, but the cohomology at L1 piece is zero, so this is again zero. And with the same argument, you prove these are zero, this all is zero. Well, this proves essentially this vanishing, and prove also the fact that now you have just a right resolution, which is the following. Sorry, a left resolution, not right, a left resolution, which is the following, and then this is just L0, and then you have L-1, L-2. And this means that F is a quotient of several copies of the trivial bundle, and so it is globally generated because it's a quotient of globally generated. And this is okay, and to conclude, if you tensor by one in this way is more difficult. Probably. Ah, yes. I have to do. Omega. Yes, if you apply now Bailinson 2f n plus 1, you get in particular that this zero remain over, and you get that this is surjective. And now you see that this just factor in the following way. You have O tensor this is just the omega 1 1 as a kernel of this map as I defined before, the kernel here. And then if this is surjective, also this is surjective, which is exactly the thesis. Okay. Well, there is a dual version of Bailinson that maybe I state in the last 5 minutes. So there is a dual complex when the building blocks are no more omega and change the role with the line bundle. The assumption are the same, F B coherent sheaf on PV. We have a complex let's call differently where MK is the sum of OJ tensor HI F minus J. You see, before omega was outside and this line bundle was inside, now essentially these two exchanged. And the conclusion is the same. Such that if this is the cohomology of this complex is just F in the middle and zero otherwise. This sometimes can be better if you want to study subvarieties, because give a resolution in terms of line bundles. So, for example, you get Hilbert CZG. For sheaves, which is a non-trivial result, and you get for granted here, because this means that if F is a coherent sheaf on PN, then get exact resolution, and the statement of Hilbert syzygy is that here you stop just after n steps. So this n is the same as this n, is not a misprint. Get exact resolution where Li are direct sum of line bundles. And well, I don't give the details, but it's again another simple application. If you twist enough in order that you get sufficiently positive, you get all the vanishing that you want, and there remains this, and you apply Bellingson version number 2. And if F is torsion free, you gain 1, so you arrive to L n minus 1, one step less. Hilbert proved maybe more. He proved for modules, and then you need one step more. You arrive to n plus 1. Why? Because there is the field. If you look at the first example I gave, the Kozul complex is just the resolution of the field as S module, and you need n plus 1 steps. Okay, I think I stop here, and tomorrow we'll give application when F is the ideal sheaf of some subvariety, especially of the Veronese variety. Okay, thanks.